Eclipse madness is sweeping North America. For the first time in 30 years, a total solar eclipse will cut across the entire United States. Anyone in its path will experience totality. The moment when the moon crosses between the Earth and the sun and completely blocks out the sun's light.
People go crazy. It's nuts. It's crazy.
Interest in the eclipse is also crazy. Many, Canadians included, plan to chase the shadow of the moon. So I sat down with CBC's science correspondent and the host of Quirks and Quarks, Bob McDonald.
I am an avid eclipse chaser. I've been chasing them since the 1970s.
To answer your questions about Monday's celestial spectacle. Bob, I am so glad you're here because we got questions from viewers. It's incredible, the tremendous interest in this event. And I know that's something that you don't just understand, you share.
You bet I share. I've seen six total
eclipses,
yes, around the world. I've seen them in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. I saw one in Africa. I saw one in Indonesia. I saw one in Hawaii. I saw one here in Canada. They happen all over the world. They're a great excuse to travel. And it's one of the most spectacular sights you can see if you're in the right place at the right time. There's a very narrow place you gotta be, but boy, it's more than just the moon passing in front of the sun. The whole environment changes. Everything changes. The sky turns color, this cobalt blue fades down to a gold all the way around the horizon, like nothing you've ever seen before. And this is all happening in the middle of the day. The temperature goes down, birds take off, people go crazy. It's nuts, it's crazy.
As you wax poetic, yes. I can't wait for the event to arrive. And we're going to talk about where people can see what in the course of our conversation today. But can we start with the basics and our viewer questions? I put the question to my nieces, 11-year-old Asha, 9-year-old Jessica, who were not really quite understanding why there's such a hoopla over this. So let's begin there. Why is this so rare?
Well, actually, it's not rare, Heather. It actually happens all the time. But for any one spot on the Earth, it is rare. But eclipses are common. So let's just get back to basics, as you said. So we have our planet Earth, which spins on its axis once a day, and it goes around the sun. So I'm going to make you the sun.
Okay. You're the center of your universe?
You're very bright, yes. Okay, so the Earth would be going around your head like this, and we're doing this. The moon, and by the way, this isn't big enough. The moon's bigger than this, which is just easy for me. So the moon goes around the Earth once a month. Now, if the moon went around the Earth, around the equator like this, we would have an eclipse every month, because an eclipse is just when the sun, the moon, and the Earth all line up.
Okay.
And all the eclipse is the shadow of the moon cast on the Earth. That's all it is. Just a shadow going by. Big deal. What's the big deal, right? Just a shadow. But it doesn't happen every month because, for one thing, the Earth is tipped a bit on its axis like this, and the moon does not go around the middle. It's on an angle. Its orbit goes up and down like this. So usually its shadow is either above us or below us, so it misses us. But it depends what part of the Earth is facing the sun that day. It's always spinning. So while they do happen every couple of years, the shadow might pass over an ocean, which it usually does, or another country. This time, it happens to be passing right over North America, and the path of totality is across the United States.
And it hasn't done that since 1979? Decades, anyway.
Yeah, 1979, yes. It went across Canada, and there was one that went up through Winnipeg, or Brandon, Manitoba, and Red Lake, Ontario. That was one I saw. And there's another one that's going to come this way in 2024, I think. We're going to see the next one.
Hence the excitement, if it happens where you are.
Yeah.
It's amazing that they can predict when they're going to return to.
It's remarkably precise, because the moon is a very good clock, and so is the Earth.
All right.
Okay.
So as you said, in Canada, we're not going to be in the path of totality. So let me bring in some other questions. From Edith Dixon, you mentioned that in Canada won't be in the path of totality, but Edith wants to know, will we be able to see the eclipse in southwestern Ontario? What day and at what time?
Well, the date is August 21st, and for Southern Ontario, it begins around noon and goes till about 1:30, around totality. But for all of Canada, we will not see the total eclipse, because we're only going to see part of the sun covered. In Vancouver, it starts around 9:30 in the morning. So Vancouver is going to see about almost 90% of the sun covered. So it'll turn into a very thin crescent, but there will still be sun visible. And in Southern Ontario, it's, I think, about 75% covered. So a little more than half the moon will be covered. You'll see it looking like a disc, or like a sort of a sickle shape is what the sun will look like. So Canada's only getting a partial eclipse. If you want to see totality, that thing I was talking about where the whole sky changes, there's a very narrow band that runs from Oregon to South Carolina right across the United States. And it's only about 100 kilometers wide. It changes depending on where and what location you're at, but that's where you need to be to see totality.
And many are going there.
Including me. I'm going to Casper, Wyoming.
Oh, really?
Because it's a desert state. I'm hoping for clear skies.
When you say you have to look at this and you have to protect your eyes, the natural tendency would be, I want to see what this is.
Yes.
And I want to experience it for myself. Georgina Johnson, with a question exactly to that point, what eye protection do you need to safely watch the eclipse?
Right. So in Canada, everyone needs eye protection. You cannot watch this with your eyes anywhere in Canada. So one of the things you can do, there are these commercial eclipse viewers that are now available, mm-hmm. and you have to make sure that they have certification on the back that says that they've been certified and also endorsed by the International Astronomical Union.
Okay, because there are lots of scams
there
out there, aren't there?
Fakes? Sunglasses don't do it. You can use welding glass. Sometimes that'll work. But you need these things to do it. They have to be approved. And the way you know that they work is that when you put these things on, what do you think? You
it's like? A good look.
Like that?
Good look for you.
You should see absolutely nothing at all.
Really?
There should be nothing. Even I'm looking at a really bright spotlight now, I can see nothing. It's only the sun that will go through this. And even when you see that, it's very, very dim. So if you can see anything through this besides the sun, don't use them. The other thing to do is to hold them up to a bright light, and if you see any pinholes in them, mm-hmm. don't use them. Okay, so if they're bent or wrinkled. Mm-hmm. So that's one way to do it is
even in a partial eclipse situation, partial solar eclipse.
Especially
situation.
In the partial especially. Eclipse. Because during the total eclipse, you don't need these. That's the beauty of it. During the total eclipse, you look out, and the sun is completely covered. And you see this incredible corona, the atmosphere of the sun that sticks out beyond it. It looks like a combination of highly polished silver and rabbit's fur.
I'm going to mull that over for a moment.
It's brilliant white, but there's no edge to it. It's just this, it's got this like filaments and hair sticking out on the edges of it.
That's
and you
beautiful.
Can look at this with your eye. It's the atmosphere of the sun. And then within that, sometimes there are these blood red tongues sticking out, which are huge eruptions coming off the sun that are bigger than the Earth. And you can see this with your eye.
With your naked eye.
But it's only during total. So in Canada, you can't do that.
Okay, so you need protection
you
like
need this.
This. And not to be fear-mongers or to raise concerns, but what are the dangers of looking that without protection like
You'll
that?
Fry your eyeball. You'll fry your eyeball. You know how you can take a magnifying glass and burn a piece of
yes.
paper in the sun? That's what your eyes will do. The lens of your eye is a magnifying glass. It'll fry your retina. But you're naturally not going to look at it. As soon as you look at the sun, it's too bright. You don't. So don't do it, okay? Just don't do it. Here's another way, okay? Another technique.
Right.
This is the one I like. You take a pair of binoculars, and again, never, ever, ever look at the sun through binoculars.
Okay.
So instead, you turn your back to the sun. Put the binoculars over your shoulder like this. Point the binoculars at the sun. And then, see if I can do this. Take a piece of paper and project the sun on the paper.
It'll
go through the binoculars. You will get two images of the sun. You can even focus it. And you'll see it. You'll see a perfectly clear image of the sun. You might even see sun spots. Dark spots on the sun, and do it in your own shadow. So stand like this with the sun behind you and project it down, and you'll see two perfectly clear images. You can do it on a white wall, you could do it on a sidewalk. So that's another way.
But never look through these yourself.
And the third way is to make a pinhole camera. Now, I've tried it using two pieces of paper where you just put a little pin. Can I borrow your pen?
Sure.
Okay, so you just punch a little hole in a piece of paper, just with a pen, very small hole, and make a projector like that. This doesn't work. You'll see a little crescent that way. Or you can use your fingers. I've done this as well. I've done this while riding. You make your fingers into a cross like this,
right.
And then bring them all together so that there's very, very small openings like this, and project that onto the ground, and you'll see a bunch of little crescents, which is the crescent sun. And you can also, if you're underneath a leafy tree, The space between the leaves will sometimes make little crescents on the ground, you can see.
Fantastic.
So there's lots of different ways to see it, but don't look at it with your eyes.
Sounds like the binoculars might give you perhaps
the best view of all of that. Yeah.
And what about, I mean, that's obviously the same rule for everyone. I was thinking back to an eclipse, a solar eclipse, it might have been total years and years ago. But when I was a little girl, my mother in the house, closing all the drapes, keeping it so dark, so afraid that I, little girl, might inadvertently look out and cause damage. So Zara wonders, are children at any particular risk?
Well, children are as much risk as anybody. They are curious, they do want to look up. So I don't want to be a fear monger about this and say, you know, like, oh no, don't go outside, don't go outside. Educate the kids. Educate the kids. Tell them what's going on. Make them smart. Kids are smart enough. They can figure it out. Don't look at the sun directly and show them these other ways to see what's going on and explain it to them. I think everybody will be fine.
Don't miss the experience. Jennifer Anderson writes, again, along this point, is it dangerous to be out and about driving?
No. Like I say, most people, especially towards the east where the effect isn't as great, might not even notice because it'll just seem like, well, it's a cloudy day today. Gee, this kind of dull out, but keep going on with their thing.
In Canada, you've mentioned the best viewing will be on the West Coast. So Sharon Patterson wonders about the wildfires. Of course, in the interior of BC, we've been talking about that, the smoky skies and
that.
The haze. You're living that. That's where you're based, of course. How will the skies affect viewing?
Well, the smoke will make it more difficult to see the corona, the atmosphere of the sun, that white surrounding it. But it might actually provide an interesting filter. Because I've been noticing over the last while with all the smoke in BC that the sun has been red. Hmm. And when it rises, we're having red sunrises and red sunsets. So as the sunlight goes down, it'll probably turn into a red crescent, which could be very, very interesting.
All right. From Diane, similar to this point, obviously the cloud, the haze, the smoke is going to affect the viewing. But conversely, will the eclipse affect the weather?
That's actually one of the scientific investigations they're doing during this. They're going to be flying jets up trying to chase the shadow across because there is a cooling effect that happens. You're shading the sun. So the atmosphere on a very local scale does go down and you feel it during totality. The temperature drops, especially the ones that I've seen in the tropics like Africa. It's a hot, sweaty day. You're out at noon, you know, mad dogs and Englishmen outside in the hot sun. You're sweating like crazy. But then all of a sudden it turns quite cool and it's very nice. So there are local effects where the atmosphere does cool, and the scientists are very interested in the changes in the atmosphere, how much shading the sun does that, because, you know, there are some crazy schemes in the future to try to avert global warming by putting stuff up in the atmosphere to shade the sun to try to do this, and we don't know if that experiment is going to work. So here's a natural experiment that's going to come along for a few minutes. We're going to shade the sun and see what happens in the atmosphere. So there's a lot of interest in that, not just the eclipse, but what's happening on the Earth as well.
So following up on that point, of those NASA planes that are going to fly within the path of totality to do their research, Dennis Enns wondered how fast he would have to fly to keep under the total eclipse.
Very fast. You would need a supersonic jet to do it, and
which
even that
have.
Wouldn't keep up with it. The shadow itself, the speed changes as it goes across the Earth because the surface of the Earth is curved. So it's fast at the beginning, then it slows down, then it speeds up again. But it's generally around 2,300 kilometers an hour, which is way beyond the speed of sound.
Yes.
So supersonic jets, I know there was once a plan to try to fly the Concorde through an eclipse that was happening in Siberia, and that was so fast, even the Concorde couldn't keep up with it.
So let me bring in some other questions. From Charla Soli. A question, again, that speaks to the rarity of this, because the perception is, why is it that Canada never experiences a total solar eclipse? And you've already said it happens, but why not more often?
Well, it's rare for any one part of the country. Again, it's because the Earth is spinning, because of the mechanics of the moon's going up and down, and so you never know which part of the, different parts of the country or different parts of the globe are going to be facing. But Canada did have one in 1979 that went across Manitoba and Ontario, then out to the east. And in the 1960s, you mentioned earlier, you saw one as a kid. I remember that as well. And in fact, there's a song by Carly Simon called You're So Vain.
Sure.
And one of the lines was, you flew your Learjet to Nova Scotia to see a total eclipse of the sun. That was in the early 1960s.
Exactly.
And that one went through Nova Scotia. And we have one coming up in 2024 that's going to go right over Toronto and it's going to go over the east coast. It's going to be stunning.
All right. I'm booking you for 7 years out. We'll talk about this again. Can you hold that up again and hold up the ball, which you said is not the right proportion?
Right.
So again, the moon, how much smaller than Earth?
The moon's about half the size of the Earth, okay. But it's 400 times smaller than the sun.
Okay.
The sun's 400 times farther away, so they appear the same size.
But how does it that the moon, which is that size relative to both the sun and the Earth, how is it that it's able to cast a shadow that's about 110 kilometers wide?
Again, good question.
That was Jane Edmonds' question.
Yes, yes. Well, the shadow that the moon casts is a cone. So it starts out as the width of the moon, but then as it comes to the Earth, it's a cone. And we're right at the tip of the cone.
Okay.
So that's why the shadow is so small. Now, here's the thing. Mm-hmm. The moon is very slowly getting further away from the Earth. Every year, it's about 3 or 4 centimeters further away. So eventually, it'll be too far away, and that cone will not reach the Earth, and we will no longer have total solar eclipses. We'll only have annular eclipses. The moon will be too small, so the sun will look like a ring, which we do get now because the moon's distance does vary a bit. But eventually, we won't have total solar eclipses at all. So see them now. By the way, they're going to disappear 620 million years from now.
We should be
We still should be okay. But eventually, they will stop. So like I say, it's unique to the Earth. We're the only planet that has total solar eclipses. Mm-hmm. And I think it's fabulous that we get to see them. And this one get to drive to it. How nice.
We have something else that's unique. And Paul Tilley has picked up on that in his question. We call that the moon. Why isn't there something more romantic like Phobos or Ganymede or, you know, Callisto or Europa or any of the other great moon names?
I agree. That's our moon has the worst name, the. What a terrible moon, the. Although she's also been called Luna, which is nice. But yeah, I think we should come up with a better name. Europa, Ganymede, Callisto, all these. What a Triton, Titan. I don't know. It's just always been there,
cast
I guess.
Our mind to that.
Sort of next door, you take it for granted. Oh yeah, the old moon, yeah, it's always there.
Our final viewer question, we come back to a child's perception. Axton Morris, who's 9, wondering what would happen if not the moon, but a huge asteroid passed by the sun. Would that create an eclipse?
It would, but it would not cover the entire sun because asteroids are much, much smaller. Asteroids are flying mountains. If there was an asteroid large enough to cause an eclipse of the sun, I would be worried more about the asteroid than I would about the eclipse, because something that big would wipe out everything on Earth.
Near miss.
Yeah, yeah, that would not be a good day. So asteroids are far too small to do that.
Axton, that's a great question, and all of our viewer questions were amazing. Thank you for them. I have one more question. You mentioned NASA jets flying. What do scientists hope to learn from studying this eclipse?
Eclipses provide us with a view of the sun's atmosphere that we can't get otherwise. There's a mystery on the sun. Mm-hmm. You know, we know the sun is a ball of gas, but it actually has an atmosphere above that, this corona. And it turns out that the corona is hotter than the sun itself. We think the sun's pretty hot, you know, 50 million degrees in the middle, 10,000 on the outside. The corona, as soon as you get above the surface of the sun, it goes up to more than 1,000,000 degrees. And there's always been a question, why is it so hot? What's the source of that? Mm-hmm. In order to see that, you've got to get right to the surface. And our telescopes, they put artificial moons in them. It's called a coronagraph. You put in a little thing to replicate the moon to cover the sun so that you can look down at the base of the corona. They're not as good as the moon itself. So the moon is so good at covering the sun so exactly, we can see right down to the base of that corona and see that area where that heating is happening and try to answer this mystery. They got some pretty good ideas, but that's one of the things they'll be looking at. So they'll be looking at the mystery of the corona itself, which is important because we live in it. We live within the sun. Mm-hmm. The sun's atmosphere extends right out. We get northern lights because of the particles coming from the sun. We get our power systems knocked out every once in a while because of storms on the sun. So it's really important to know this area right at the base of that corona. So eclipses are the best way to do that. They only get a few minutes to do it, but they're looking pretty, pretty hard.
I understand the magic. You know, I got a message from a viewer saying how much he was looking forward to this segment because Bob makes science so interesting. You always do. You have again. Thank you so much. So get on that motorcycle and head down there.
Sure.
Can I persuade you to do some reporting for
us from there? We'll see what we can do. I don't know where exactly I'm going to be, but it might be on Skype or my cell phone. But
all right.
Absolutely.
Stay tuned on CBC News.
Okay.
Thank you so much for
this. Thank you, Heather. It's been a great pleasure.